I've entitled this message, Expectations. As I read through this scripture, and I've read it many, many times, as many of you have, and you're so familiar with the story, but I wonder what expectations we all have. I wonder what expectations you have of me this morning, knowing the story. I wonder what expectations you might have as you read through the prodigal and his behavior, or the older son and his behavior. Maybe even the father's reaction. And so as we move forward in this season of Lent,
I'm going backwards. We're going to figure it out. There we go.
As we move forward in the season of Lent, we're taking a journey that's towards the cross. And we're being reminded that this is a time when we should be praying, fasting, and seeking repentance, and trying really hard to work on our relationship with Christ. Joan has spoke the last couple Sundays on transforming grace, sufficient grace, amazing grace. If we had gone by the lectionary last week, you would have read about how bad things happen to good people and good things happen to bad people. And so in light of that, we are called to repent, because you just don't know when the time or the day might come when something could happen. And so now we further this progression on this concept of repentance in Lent. But this morning I would ask that we would not focus on the sin, but on the Father's reaction to the sin. And so this morning, as we read through, we have an audience of sinners and tax collectors, scribes and Pharisees. So that's who Jesus is speaking to. And you can almost divide these two up and say, okay, the top two kind of go together and the bottom two go together based on the way their behavior is. But nevertheless, they're having a problem. The scribes and the Pharisees are murmuring and saying, what is it that he can go eat with sinners? He welcomes sinners. What kind of guy is he? And Jesus is trying to get them to understand that he welcomes the sinners. He welcomes those who are lost. He tries to help them be found. And so in response to their question, how is it that you can eat with sinners? He gives them three parables. The parable of the lost sheep, the parable of the lost coin, and the parable of the prodigal. Now the last two parables are found in Luke only. The other ones found in the other Gospels. But he's trying to give them an overall theme of what is happening here. And in these three parables, there are common threads in each of them. Something very valuable, something very important has been lost. And not only has it been lost, but they go looking for it. In some way, shape, or form, they go looking for whatever that valued thing is. A sheep, a coin, a son. And then there's this wonderful reunion when they discovered it, and a celebration. Trying to get these people to understand that if they could just change their ways, they would be much like the people or the things in this story. So, today we're going to focus on the parable of the prodigal. Again, we've heard this story time after time, but did you know what the word prodigal meant? Anybody? Did they have any idea what that word meant? Wasteful? I didn't. I looked it up. It means wasteful. And in this case, we're talking about wasteful in terms of money. But I think it's even bigger than that, isn't it? Resources, time, talents, all of that above. And so, in this case, I have to say that outside of the parable of the prodigal, I don't think I've ever heard that word used before. Has anybody? I really haven't, other than in scripture, in reference to this particular parable. So what we have here is we have an older and a younger son. And the younger son goes to his father and he says, hey, give me my share of this estate. He knew that should his father pass away, by Jewish law, he would be entitled to one-third of the estate, because the standard was the oldest gets double what everybody else has. So because there's only two, the older gets two-thirds, he gets a third. I want you to understand for just a moment that in order to give his son a third of the property, a third of all that he has, what do you have to do, Dan, in order to give, if your kids came to you and said, I want my share right now, what are you going to have to do in order to give it to them?
Call my lawyer.
You're way ahead of the truth. The guy's going to have to sell stuff. It's not like he has a third of his estate sitting in cash that he can just hand over to the son, right? So that means that he's put in a position where he's going to have to sell a third of all that he has. Can you imagine doing that? And handing it to your son, knowing what his intentions are. But see, this son felt very entitled to what he knew that he would get. I mean, my dad dies, so a lot of people believe that he was wishing his father dead. Because, hey, if you want a third, if you're asking for a third before I ever die, it's almost like you expect me to be gone. And so there were some expectations from the younger son that his father would give it to him, that he could take that money and do whatever he wants because it's his. And he was entitled to it because he was the son of the father. And amazingly, the father doesn't withhold it. He gives it to his son. And what does the son do? He goes off to a distant country. Now, there are plenty of definitions for distant country. Many say it's wherever God is not. It's going as far away from God as you can. So in this case, he being a Jew, it's like saying that I'm going to abandon my Jewish heritage and culture, and I'm going to go into exile into some Gentile pagan country, so that none of the other Jews are around to criticize me and critique me. Because what good is it going to do if you hand me all that money and then I go right back into my own, you know, culture? They all know what I'm supposed to do and not do. So that's not going to get me anywhere. I know what I want to do with that money. So I've got to leave. And that's like walking away from God. It's putting ourselves in a sinful state. Because again, it's separating ourselves. It's serving our flesh and not our spirit. It's chasing after worldly wealth and worldly pleasure. And at the end of the day, will that really bring us happiness? Will it really make us content? Will we feel fulfilled? This man had to go figure it out on his own. So off he goes. In today's terms, we think of him as getting involved in sex, drugs, and prostitutes and having the time of his life. But there came a day when the money ran out. And not only did the money run out, but so did the friends and the drugs and the alcohol and all the other things. So despite the fact that Sharon and I were friends and we were drinking and drugging together, come on, sister. Right? When my money ran out, and I've been kind of feeding her little habits. But when the money ran out, Sharon says, so long, sister. I got nothing to give you. He says, sorry, woman. I got no bed for you. Right? You're not sleeping under my roof. All the friends disappear. Everything disappears. And he finds himself completely desperate. Not only did his resources exhaust themselves, but a famine came through the land. So some people say, well, he became a victim of circumstance. Hardly doubt that. His circumstances where he wasted his money. He didn't plan for the future. And now he finds himself desperate. So he gives himself to somebody else and says, listen, let me be your hired hand. And they said, fine, go feed the pigs. See, he's in this Gentile society. Because if he were Jewish, can they play with pork? No, not even supposed to touch it, right? But yet he's going to get right down in the pig pen. I call it a pig pen experience. Because he is down in the dirty, he is feeding the pigs, and he is so desperate that what the pigs are eating looks appetizing. And he gets so low and so desperate that as he's there, he comes to his senses, they say. Because he says to himself, the way I'm going, what's this going to look like in another day, another week, another year? And he says, I got to do something about this. And the phrase came to his senses. is a very important phrase, because it says that he took a look at his life, he evaluated it, and he said, I got to do something about it. Perhaps if I could go to my father and ask for forgiveness, he could forgive me. Maybe he would. And maybe if he could just take me in as his hired hand. I don't have to be the son. See, that expectation was that I don't need to be the son. I don't need to be part of the family. I just want to be a hired hand. Because the hired hands were cared for. They were fed. They had a place to sleep. I'll take that over where I'm at. And so he gathered his pride and he set home, off to go home. Now, while he was still a long ways off, Scripture says that his father saw him. So in my mind, I envision this filthy, dirty young man starting to trudge his way home. In his mind, he's processing, will he forgive me? What's this going to be like? Will he reject me? I need to ask for repentance, not only from him, but from God. And while he's still a ways off, he sees in the distance somebody kind of pacing back and forth. And as he gets closer, he realizes that it's really his father. And against all tradition, his father catches eyes with him and runs to him. Let me tell you right now, no patriarch of any family ever would run. But this man doesn't care about culture, doesn't care about other expectations, but he ran to his son. And as the son is saying, Father, I'm sorry, forgive me, I'm so sorry, the father is embracing him and loving him and kissing him and welcoming him back. And he says, bring out the robe, the best one. Bring out a pair of sandals for his feet. Bring out the ring. The ring is a status thing. It's like walking in and all of a sudden you go from rags to having the silk tie and the nice coat on. Best example I can think of is Peter wears a Michigan ring on his hand. And anyone who looks at that goes, oh, he's probably a Michigan grad. He's went to school there, class rings. Well, in this case, for that young man to have had a ring on signified he was part of a family. And so it wasn't that he was just getting to come back as some hired hand. He was reinstated into the family, and that was a big deal. And despite the fact that he was filthy and stinky, physically and spiritually, the father embraced him and welcomed him back. In fact, he called for the fatted calf. I don't know if you know that as a general rule, they didn't have meat with their meals. The only time they ever had things like a calf or even the young goat was if there was something really, really special happening. And in this case, it was really special because the young son had come home. So as they call for the party, what does the older brother do? Is he happy that the brother's home? Oh, no. Oh no, he is ticked off. He hears the music. He says, what's going on over there? And they say, guess what? Your brother's home. Your dad's throwing a party. In fact, he even killed the fatted calf. And the young man is mad. And he refuses to join the party. I'm not going to that party. Are you kidding? Do you know what my brother did to my dad? That's so disrespectful. How can he do this? Yet the father went after the older son. Again, that's not something you do. The patriarch would never leave a party to go after his other son and say, listen, you and I got to talk. I don't understand what your problem is. Don't you understand that your younger brother's back home now? Isn't that enough for you? But it's not, right? See, the problem is that the older son says to the father, I don't get it. I've been working like a slave for you. And you don't even give me the goat. Like, come on. To me, as a father, that would break my heart. Because I realize that my son living under my own roof doesn't love me the way I would like him to love me. What kind of a relationship is there when you work for your father like a slave? Doing it out of duty, not doing it out of love. And what Jesus is trying to point out here is this is the kind of behavior that the scribes and the Pharisees were having. They were resembling the older son because they did everything that was commanded, but they did it out of duty and obligation. They didn't do it out of love. They didn't do it because they were in relationship. In fact, the older son was so critical and judgmental of his younger brother that it was hardening his heart too. Even that in and of itself is sinful behavior. And the Lord, and Jesus is trying to impress them, these kinds of things upon them. A lot of people want to separate these two parables and say, you know, there's really two parables in one here. You got the younger brother, you got the older brother. And who is it that you relate to? I've heard that said many times. But in reality, that's not what God wants us to focus on today. God wants us to focus on the fact that we have a gracious God. And whether you resonate with one or the other, and I'll tell you, I used to be like the older. I was always trying to be the goody two-shoes. And I could always find fault with choices that my other brothers and sisters made. And at the end of the day, I was just as sinful, if not more sinful, for being that way. 100%. And I always did what my mother told me. And I loved my mother. I really did love my mother. But were there sometimes resentment? Yeah. Yeah. And everyone said, oh, you're the favorite one. That whole argument up there, that's an argument that still today happens. Oh, you're the youngest, you're the favorite. No, I just stayed in contact the most with my mother because I was the youngest. So I had more time with her and that relationship, you know, stayed. But at the end of the day, what's our take-home message in all of this? It's that, number one, we have free will. We have free will. And if we want to choose to go live in a distant country, we can do that. God's not going to stop us. We can live with God or without God. But we recognize that if we live without God, life is not going to be as easy. Because as a Christian, living with God, look how difficult our life is. Vicki and I were talking this morning about how much does God think we can take? Because we're about to break sometimes. And it's like, how do people do it without God? That's my question. You're still going to have trials whether you're with God or without God. The difference is your perspective when you have God to work through it with you and to help you through it. And no matter where we're at in life, God welcomes us back with open arms. In fact, God is the only God that constantly pursues us. In every other religion, you pursue the God. But in Christianity, God pursues us. He's always watching, always waiting, always welcoming with open arms to embrace us. And when he does, he always restores us to the family. One of the problems that the older son had, as did the scribes and Pharisees, is if Jesus welcomes the sinners, is there going to be room for me? And the answer is there's room for all of us. We should not resent that someone would come to Christ, that someone would be reunited with God. Yet it is difficult. It is difficult, and I confess that. When I read in the paper that someone's done some horrific act, and then I find, you know, later on you hear that they've actually become a Christian. I remember reading years ago, and some of you young people may not remember Jeffrey Dahmer's, but he did some horrific, horrific things. And I heard that he was a Christian when he, you know, I can't answer for that. That's in God's hands. I cannot. But the reality is we should never resent when one person reunites with God or finds God for the first time. We should be celebrating. And that's my hope, that we wouldn't think that that distant country looks all that good, that we would want to be welcomed by the Father and embraced by the Father. Amen.